Father, let's pray over our children's church. All right, we're going to pray. You ready? Everybody bow your heads, close your eyes. All right. Father, thank you, God, that you've given us these children. You've entrusted us with teaching them your word, and your way, and your will, what you'd have them to do. God, I pray they understand it from a young age, and that you would use them in ways that we don't even understand right now, God. They might be the next Billy Graham or just anyone who's been a great saint of God. May they usher in the presence of God in their generation too, as we trying to in this generation. God, we love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right, y'all have a good time. Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Yeah. As for the rest of you adults, don't think you'll have such a good time, okay? James chapter 5, and we'll try to give you something that'll help you today. I really believe if you'll stay with me for a little bit and take this word to heart, it will help you. Because we're all having trouble, some form, some shape, some fashion right now. I don't know what you're going through. I know what I got going on. I know what's going on around me. And a lot of times the very thing we turn last to is the very thing we need the most. So James chapter 5, verse 13 is our scripture for today as we're going through the book of James. It says, are any of you suffering hardships? You should pray. Are any of you happy? You should sing praises. God, help us to go to the one who can help us. God, I know you. You're always there for me, Father. I thank you that you've never forsaken me. You've never let me down. God, you've always brought me through every trouble in my life, taking care of me. You've always supplied my needs according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. You've made the crooked path straight. You saved my soul. You forgave me of my sin. Got to give you all praise and all honor and all glory. Help us to understand this morning what we need to do, Father, to relieve stress and tension, to help us through hard times. Help us to understand these things in biblical context here today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So James is talking to a bunch of people who have had a bunch of trouble. Now, in James' day, the Christians were a little different than our day. Now, we're not suffering persecution in America right now, but we will more than likely have to one day. But James is talking to those who had suffered some type of persecution. You see, in Christ's day, everybody that called themselves a Christian had trouble. They had, they got killed, they got crucified, they got tarred and feathered. It was just amazing what happened over the years. That's happened from the time of Christ till now. Burned at stakes, hung on crosses upside down, cut their heads off. I mean, they've had some hard times. Now, in American culture, we don't have a lot of hard times in that shape, in that fashion, that form fashion, but we do have a lot of hard times. And what I mean by that is, I thank God for our freedoms of 4th of July and fireworks. And I was trying to go to bed last night at 9:20, and y'all was all keeping me up with all them boom, boom, pop things. And y'all better not put your tithe in the fireworks tent last night. But, I'm serious. But I think about my freedom. But my freedom's getting less and less every day, to be honest with you. When they start telling me what I have to do as a preacher and what we have to do as a church and all these different things, I'm losing freedom, actually. Yeah. I'm so thankful for everybody who fought for my freedom. But we're going to have to suffer a little bit. We're going to have to go through some things. If any of us live to see 80, if God don't come back, if something happens and we're able to live a long life, we'll see some things that we've never seen happen on American soil. You don't have to call me a prophet. I can promise you some bad things are probably going to happen. But what are you going to do? You're going to fall apart. You're going to run and hide. You're going to be like an ostrich, stick your head in the sand. You're going to be all nervous all the time and worried. You're going to make my life miserable because you're going to be grumbling. You know what I'm saying? Like, when times come, hard times come, what are you going to do? You're going to step up and be God's people and you're going to do the things God wants you to do, or you're just going to sit back and let it take a hold of you instead of you having control of the situation? He's saying, if you're suffering hardship, what am I supposed to do? Well, he told us last week not to grumble, not to gripe. I think he tells us not to complain. He says, look at Job. If you think you've got it bad, look at Job. I think he could say that to anybody in all of history. If you think you've got it bad, look at Job. Amen? Amen. Now, he says, what am I supposed to do? I say this, you're supposed to pray. Now, prayer is probably very underutilized. How many of you, when you have hard times, talk to your mama or your daddy or your best friend or your wife? That's all good, but they're not God. And if you go to anybody else before you go to God, you've tried to short-circuit the process here. Your wife's okay. I love my wife. We talk about everything. But she can't heal my daddy from cancer. You know what I'm saying? Like, I love my wife, and I love my kids, I love my parents. I go to my dad for a lot of advice. When I was going through my divorce, my dad came to me, and my dad had been through the same thing. We talked about these things. He really helped me through a hard time, but my dad ain't God. When I was laying in the floor crying sometimes because I thought my life was over, the only one I could go to was God. And we sometimes forget that the line that we have to fill us full of power to do what we need to do in this terrible world that we're going to be living in is that line of prayer. And we've got to get back to it, church. That's why our country is in the shape it's in, because American people aren't praying people anymore. And the reason I say that is because all these years we've had more money than we could spend. We went to the lake house, we went to the boat, we went to the vacation. I'm as guilty as anybody else going to all these places, and times haven't been hard. And when everybody's up on the mountaintop, when the stock market's good, and when there's not this or that going on, everybody's fine with not praying because we can handle it ourselves, okay? Let the Great Depression hit. Let a war start. Let your wife leave. Let one of your kids get killed. Let something happen that you don't want to see happen. And that's when you understand there is power in prayer. But what God's trying to do is He's not trying to get us to that point to get us to pray. He wants us to pray all the time.
Amen.
Like, are you suffering? Pray. But then He's like, are you happy? Sing. Like, all the time. You need to be praying all the time. You need to be singing. You need to be doing these things as a constant reminder of how good God is. Even if the world is really bad, you need to know how good God is. Because here's what the Bible says. Paul said to Timothy, he said, yea, all who live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. 2 Timothy 3:12. That means if you're not suffering some type of persecution, whether it's friends, family members, Facebook or something, then you're probably not living godly enough. You probably got a form of godliness, but you're lacking the power thereof, is what the Scripture tells us. So you got to understand, if you're going to do what God says, you're fixing to have a little bit of a rough road. Not paved. It's going to be gravel probably. You're going to have some skint knees and some broke bones. Things are going to happen that you don't want to happen. But what are you going to do? Are any of you afflicted? Is there anybody in here that there ain't something going on in your family right now that needs help? No, we all. So this is for everybody that's here. What are you going to do? You're going to pray. You should pray. And when I say pray, what do I mean? I mean like knowing God's going to hear you. No, it means getting up close to God. When it says prayer here in the Greek, it means like coming up against the side of God. Like when you pray, you actually leave the place you're at. And Hebrews says you enter the throne room of God. You come boldly before the throne of God to find help and mercy in a time of need, is what Hebrews says. So when you pray, you got to look at this way. It's like some people say, I don't think He hears me, or I think I'm talking to the ceiling. I'm just telling you, I've been there before. You just keep praying, and you'll know when everything lightens up, when you break through. I don't know how else to explain it, but the more you pray, the closer you get to God, the more intimate you get, the more you understand the relationship. You might not understand what you're doing right now, but when you met your wife, you didn't have all the words to say either. Like when you started romancing your wife, or you were thinking, what do I say next? Did you stick your foot in your mouth? Well, sure you did. Some of y'all guys are still doing it all the time. I've talked to your wives. They wish you'd quit. You know, like you talk, you don't know what, sometimes it's a little awkward, sometimes you don't know what's going on, but all the time, God's called us to pray. He's called us to get in the secret place. He's called us just like Jesus. When Jesus went to the cross, Jesus made sure before he went to the cross, he went to his knees. He went to the place in the garden where there wasn't nobody else. Even after they had fed everybody, that one time they fed everybody, Jesus said, come on guys, we got to get alone. We got to get away from the crowd. And he left the guys and went somewhere else and talk to God. I like you, and I hope you like me, but if I don't get along with God by myself, I'm not going to be what I need to be with you, and you're not going to be what you need to be with me.
Amen.
And you're not going to make it. Like, you can't live the Christian life and not pray. You can't do it.
Amen.
Like, I don't know where you live, but I live in a rough place. Like, I'm not talking about my home. I got a good home, but I'm talking about just the world in general. It's trouble, amen? Like last times, last days, all this stuff. I don't know when that's going to be, but every day we live is closer to the last day, wouldn't you say?
Amen.
So it just makes me understand that what Jesus said in the Scripture, he said in Jeremiah, I'm ready to perform my word. Do you know what God's word says about prayer? Do you know what he promises you? Ask and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. If you're having trouble right now, you need to be calling out to God that your joy may be full. Whatever things you ask in prayer, believing you will receive. Matthew 21, Jeremiah 33. Call unto me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things. John 14, 14. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. John 16, whatever you ask in the Father's name, I will give it to you. James 5, 16, just a few verses down. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. And he says, I'll hear you, I'll answer you, I'll give you, I'll help you, I'll hold you, I'll love you, I'll do these things for you. He said, you know, James said a couple weeks ago, you have not because you ask not. Some of you are in a mess because you're too prideful to ask somebody for a little help. And if you don't think that carries over in your spiritual life, it will. If you're too prideful to ask somebody for directions at the gas station, you might be too prideful to ask somebody like God for directions in life.
Right.
Like, listen, guys, we don't have to. We can't be tough enough to make it through, okay? And I don't know about ladies. I don't guess y'all are macho. But me and my pride says, I got this. And God says, you ain't never had it.
Amen.
And I know that's not good English. That's my English. When you're up here, you can say what you need to say to get the point across, you know? So God's always said, you can't handle it. And I'm like, after a little while, I agree, you know? Like, for a little while, I'm going to be okay. Everything's going to be okay. I'm the man. I'm going to get this done. This is going to happen. And then I'm like, what am I going to do? And God's saying, you should have done this the whole time. You should have called on me because you didn't choose me. I chose you. And I appointed you for such a time as this so that you would abide in me and bear much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. That don't sound like the happy words of Jesus. That just sounds like plain, straight to the point kind of stuff I like. Without Jesus, I am nothing. I'm nothing. I'm not worth. I'm not a good husband. I'm not a good father. I'm not a good pastor. Without him and calling on him every day, I will never be what God has called me to be. But if I abide in him and his words abide in me, I will ask what desires of my heart I have. And he says, it will be done for you. John Wesley said, prayer is where the action is. If something's not moving in your life that you need it to be moved, you need to have faith and pray about it. A little bit of faith and a whole lot of prayer will move any mountain.
Yes.
I can promise you, you can get some things done with prayer. You say, how am I ever going to get back on my feet? You won't until you get back on your knees.
Amen.
How am I going to fix this marriage? How am I going to fix this financial thing? How are we going to fix this country? How? It's only going to be done through prayer. And you're not going to get where you need to go. It's kind of like getting in the car when it ain't got no gas in it and thinking you're going to go to Texas. You ain't going to get to where you need to go until you put the right thing in the car to make it that way. And the same way with Jesus. I know that's simple, but you're not until you get full of the Holy Spirit and ask these things of the Father. You are not ever going to be what you need to be, but there is always the truth of if you will call upon the name of the Lord, if you will humble yourself. James said, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord and he will exalt you. 2 Chronicles says, humble yourself and he will exalt the nation. He says it over and over again. If you call upon me, I will show you things that you don't even know. Like you're asking for things and you don't even know what you're asking for. You just need a help. And God's so much God that he knows the things that you don't even understand what you're asking for, and he's just going to give them to you because he loves you. Like he's going to move in your behalf. And then you're going to be so tore up at some point in your life Listen, if you've never been there, I can promise you there's some times where you don't even know what to pray.
Right.
You get in a bad enough situation, and all you'll get out of me, I don't know what to say. Don't know what to do. Don't know what to ask for. God, I'm past the point of knowing. I've just got to have some help. And it's in that point where the Holy Spirit inside of you makes intercessions and groaning through you to the Father that you don't even know what's going on, but He is speaking a heavenly language that God understands. And on your behalf, Christ is interceding to the Father. So even when you don't know what to pray, make an attempt and God will move through the Holy Spirit on your behalf.
Amen.
Prayer moves people, it moves churches, it moves mountains. If this church ever does anything for the glory of God, it'll be because people are praying long before they ever come to a service, long before they ever come to an event, long before they ever come to hear the preacher. They've been on their knees before God. But if you want to make sure this church goes nowhere, just keep on watching the TV and let the rest go. Like, everybody wants a lot of God, but they don't want to put in a lot of time. It's the McDonald's mentality. You pull up to that window and you say double cheeseburger and Diet Coke. They kind of equal each other out if y'all didn't know that. But double cheeseburger and a Diet Coke make it a large. And then you get to the window and 2 minutes and 30 seconds later, you're mad. You're mad. I've heard a baby crying. I got three of them. Just pay attention. So here you go. 2 minutes and 30 seconds later, you're going, I want to get my meal for free. Are you joking me? Calm down. Holy Spirit, patience. Okay, so we've got this mentality. God, I want it, and I want it now. But the law of the kingdom is asked. The law of the kingdom is spend some time in my presence. The law of the kingdom is abide. The law of the kingdom is get under the wing of the Almighty, the sheltering of the Almighty, and He will pour out on you what you need. You're going to have to spend some dedicated time in prayer to know that God's going to do what He needs to do in your life. Like, it can't be a flash in the pan, a drive, but like, God's not like a drive-by shooting. Thank you, Lord, I need some help. And just keep on going the way you need to go. You know, you got to spend some dedicated time. Jesus got alone. Listen, I like you, but you got to get alone with the Father. When you need some help, you need to get alone with the Father. You need to ask Him these things. You say, what do I ask Him for? Ask Him for anything. If you don't need it, He won't give it to you. And if you do need it, He'll give it to you.
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty simple, isn't it? If you ask it and it don't happen, it must not be in His will. Praise God, He knows more than we do. And then He ain't going to lead me down a path that actually something you might want right now would lead to your destruction. So you got to trust God enough to say, God, I'm trusting You. I'm praying. I'm understanding. You just do whatever You need to do in my life. I'm going to fill this oil in this lamp, and I'm going to be ready for the bridegroom to come. But until He gets there, I'm going to get talking to Him, because it's going to be real weird, Jesus showing up and the bride and the groom not even knowing each other. We're in the place we're at because of lack of prayer. But I think that's going to change. I think it'll have to change. Alfred Lord Tennyson was in the 1800s, and it's probably not something I would usually quote, but it really caught my eyes. He said these words. He said, there's a place where thou canst touch the eyes of blinded men to instant perfect sight. There's a place where thou canst say arise to dying captives bound in the chains of night. There's a place where thou canst reach the store of hoarded gold and free it for the Lord. There's a place upon some distant shore where thou canst send the worker and the word. Where is the secret place, dost thou ask? Where, O soul, it is the secret place of prayer. The people before us understood all of this stuff. And I like Facebook, and I use it to minister, and Twitter and Instagram and cell phones, and everybody can get a hold of everybody and do anything they want to do, but nobody's getting a hold of God.
Yeah.
Like, turn your phone off. Like, if I'm going to get a hold of God, I have to just turn it off. Get away from it. Close my computer. Get in the house. My wife goes to work. Kids go to the babysitter. Park my car in the garage. Close both doors. Turn off every social media thing I have and just spend time with God. In 1800s, they didn't have a lot to distract them. And I like air conditioners. I do. And I like pads and pews and carpets and cars and vehicles. I like the TV when I'm watching a show I like to watch. But I'm afraid all these technological advances have kept us from advancing in the kingdom. Like spending alone time, just getting where the Father can hear us. If you're having trouble, if you're having hardships, that's the only way it's going to change, is you can get along with the Father. Now, another definition of this word for pray, it says you should pray. If you look it up in the Greek, the word is worship. And then it says, are you happy? You should sing praises. And that's what I want to tell you about worship today. I want to talk to you for a few minutes about that. There's a place that you'll be released, like the word, the worship, and the prayer time. Those are the three places where you'll get full of the Holy Spirit and you'll be released from a lot of things. You'll have times where there's great tension on you, there's great trouble in your life, your job, all these things that are going on around you, your health, and the pressure of society, and all these things around you. And there's times where you just need to worship. You've been praying, you've been going to church or whatever, but you need to get with God's people. You need to get alone by yourself, whatever that means. Now, in the New Testament, the word there for worship is like laying down. Like if we was all singing, and people started laying on the floor, well, I'm just going to get beside myself. That's some Jesus stuff right there. Like when people start going down in the floor, that's the humble. That's that getting on your face before God. I remember at a Bible conference I was at one time in Mississippi, the preacher preached for about an hour and a half. And he was doing leg kicks. I can't do them. He does them real high. And he was just stomping and snorting. The Holy Spirit fell in that place. And when he said it was time to get with God, there was these four young guys. They was about 20 years old. And they run. It was probably twice the length of this church. And they run as hard as they could run and just dove like Pete Rose into the altar and just stayed before God on their face. So the Old Testament, we're on our face before God. The New Testament definition is this. It's like a dog licking his master's hands is what it says. So you think about that. Anybody got a dog in here? No. Dog's happy to see you. Loves you. If we love God like our dogs love us, we'd be something, wouldn't we? We'd do something for the kingdom. But here's this dog, runs up. And like, I ain't much on animals, okay? We had farms, and I don't get attached to anything like that. But a lot of people like animals, so they're letting dogs lick them, and they're just sorry. I'm like, that's nasty, you know? And you ain't shaking my hand now, all that slobber. But here's that dog, and you just think about it. And God's like this. He's saying, I want you to love on me. Like, I want you to praise me. I want you to, it says, are you happy? Sing. But it also says, if you're sad, sing. If you're happy, worship. If you're sad, worship. Like God's hands are out. His hands are where the blessings come from, where He bestows upon you the things you need to get through the times you're in. And you need to go up and you just need to love all over Him like a dog licking his master's hands. You need to be intimate with Christ and understand that is what He wants from you. This is not just a bunch of crazy stuff. When we say, let's worship, I'm talking about it's time God's doing this and we're going to fall at His feet. We're going to shout His praises. We're going to tell Him how good He is, how lovely He is. We are going to love on Him until we shake the portals of heaven and He manifests His Spirit in this place like I believe He wants to do. I say all the time, worship breaks bondage. Well, you think a little bit about Paul and Silas when they were in jail. Y'all remember that story? So when you do what God wants you to do, sometimes you go to jail. And so they're worshiping. Well, they weren't at first. This is the inner prison. So here's the outer prison. They cast them in stocks and bond, inner prison. They're chained them to the wall. And Paul wrote in the church, into Colossae, in the book of Colossians, he said, always singing, encouraging each other with spiritual hymns and songs. So Paul, I think, already had this in his mind when he's in the book of Acts locked in this prison. So they're in this prison, and what would you be doing if you've just been thrown in jail for preaching the Word of God? Oh, God, help me. God, hell, I don't know why you'd let this happen to your servant. Kind of like a Jonah moment. I don't know why you've asked me to do this. You know it wasn't my plan. I don't. But here's, they're praising God. They start singing. It said that, I don't know what they were singing. Let my people go, or break every chain, or I don't know what they were singing. But they were singing something, and all of a sudden everything starts to shake. The jail, the chains break off, the doors fly open, and it said every prisoner was set free. Now listen to me real good. There's somebody sitting inside you right now that can't praise
Because they're going through a hard time, and they're suffering, and they're going through hardship. But if some of you that were happy would get a little bit more happy, it might set the rest of the prisoners free.
Amen.
You see what I'm saying? Like, get a hold of something. Most people can't do this because it ain't never got a hold of them. Like, when God gets a hold of you, there's something inside of you that needs to be shook loose. Like, I don't care what you think about what I'm doing. I'm up here parading around like a chicken right now, like a rooster. Y'all sitting out there, I don't care. Like, I'm going to do what God calls me to do. Hands up, slots, bits, grind, whatever, laying in the floor, jumping up and down. But I'm going to give Him the praise He deserves, because I'm not going to waller in self-pity and all these other things. And woe as me, because God's as good now as He's ever been, no matter what I'm going through.
Amen.
You better hear it. In 2 Chronicles chapter 20, King Jehoshaphat was bowing his head to the ground. There were some mighty armies coming against him. And he looked at them. He said, "Listen to me, all you people of Jerusalem and Judah. Believe in the Lord your God, and you will be able to stand firm." After consulting with the people, the king appointed singers. They walked ahead of the army, singing the Lord praises to His holy splendor. This is what they said: "Give thanks to the Lord, and His faithful love endures forever." So they're all fixing to get their heads cut off because they're real little, and there's three armies coming against them. And he said, "Let's sing. Jesus loves the little children." You'd be like, "You crazy? I got to get a sword, or I got to get gone. They're coming." The king's saying, "Oh, be still and know that He is God." They put these singers in front of them. They go marching out. And it's just like God to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask for thanks. They go out to the point where they look over where the army should be that were coming against them, and everybody was laying dead in the valley. Not a single soldier was standing there. They all had been slain by the Spirit of God just because the worship of the people. They said, "We're not going to let this get us down. We're just going to love the Lord. We're going to worship Him. We're going to serve Him, praising Him forever. Your faithful love endures forever." Not a single one of the enemy had escaped. If you don't think praising God will set you free, will set your bondage free, will set somebody else free, if you don't think praising God will change the enemy's mind or destroy what he wants to do, if you think it's a bunch of silliness and nonsense and we're just all acting a fool up here, well, that's fine for you. You go ahead and stay in your dark, damp area. You go ahead and get in your depression and all that stuff that you're afraid to let go of, because God just says, "Give me what I deserve." Listen, I used to be there. I used to say, "Well, all those people acting a fool, dancing and all that stuff." You know, David danced before the Lord. David was a man after God's own heart. I don't know why Baptists are against dancing. I don't understand it. David, that man after God's own heart, he dancing the jig, and we get in trouble for doing it.
Come on.
Well, we're against mixed bathing and dancing. What's that mean? Mixed bathing? My bathtub ain't big enough for two people. But that's not the point. So David's got this kingdom here, and what's he do? He appoints singers. He appoints Levitical singers. Asaph and his family, there's 200 in this family, there's 245 singers in this choir and all these people. And all they do, they go before the army, they go behind the army. They have people playing tambourines. When David come in from just a little kid and Saul, they just killed Goliath. Here comes all the women meeting them, singing the praises of the Lord. All throughout the scripture, you see it over and over again. I can show you in the Old Testament, and then I can show you in the New Testament. Go ahead and look up worship, singing His praises from Matthew to Revelation. It's all the way through there. You cannot disprove that God doesn't want something to come out of your mouth besides that everyday old humdrum stuff you've been spitting so far.
Come on.
You got to get out of the same praises. What it said here, and I thought it said to twitch or to twang. That's kind of like me, twitching and twanging up there. You know, I don't know if that's really what it means. That's what I think country. I'm kind of country, twitching, twanging. That's some Greek country. It says to play an instrument, to play a string. This is New Testament now. Don't get sideways here. People who don't like music in the church, here it is. Play a stringed instrument. Celebrate the divine by worship with music. Making melody, singing songs and spiritual hymns. Let go of the traditions and let God get you into something you've never had before. You say, well, that ain't how I do it. Listen, if I can prove to you how you do it's not right and how the Bible says to do it is right, then you need to go with the Bible and not how you've always done it. Listen, let's let go of tradition. We don't want a spirit of religion. We want a spirit of reality. This is what the Word of God says. Some of you that are happy need to let it out, because somebody beside you is hurting. Like, I'm happy. And I just want you all. I want to joy the love of the Lord inside of us. Peace and happiness, the fruit of the Spirit. And sometimes that's hard, but we're all in different places in life. So when I'm not doing real good, one, you're going to have to cheer me up, okay? I told them the other day, we're kind of like the cheerleaders of God. We're telling everybody, God's good and His mercy endures forever. And everybody's like, yeah, yeah, that's good. And we don't mind cheerleaders at a ball game, touchdown, all these things. We get excited, throwing stuff. Or when somebody, man, go to Titans game, and here we go, touchdown. And I'm running with them. Like, yes, I'm running down the sideline, you know. And then we get to church, we got to calm down. Can't be excited about the things of God. Can't be excited about the ways of God. I mean, get some of that fire in your bones that you cannot. Listen, the Old Testament prophet said that the fire was so strong in his bones that he couldn't keep it shut up. He said there had to be an opening of his mouth to speak the oracles of God. Church is not a place for dead. Reverence is a place for life. Holy Spirit filled resonation for all that God has always done. And you need to know that. God's expecting you to open your mouth and tell Him how good He is. If you're having a bad day, tell Him. You ever been around somebody and you're having a bad day and you just tell them, even though you don't feel like it, like husband and wife. Now you're having a bad day. And you say, well, I'm going to do this whether I want to or not. And you say, baby, I love you. You're beautiful. You know, after a little while, it'll make you feel better too. Some of y'all need to try. Some of y'all men need to try that. If I did, I wouldn't tell you. You're stubborn, Jesse. So you got to just sometimes say things even when it doesn't feel right. You say, well, I got to feel it. Sometimes you're not going to feel it until you do what you're told to do. Everybody likes good, and I like a good feeling. I like a good feeling. But sometimes the wrong type of music can give me a good feeling. You know what I'm saying? It ain't all about the feeling. It's about knowing what He said. It's about knowing who He is. It's about knowing what He's going to do. It's about knowing He's in your heart. And I promise you, you get to thinking about that for just a little while. Holy Spirit's living inside you. All that starts resonating around. The song starts stirring in your heart. And you're going to be able to do some stuff you didn't think there's going to be a feeling. You're going to start singing. You're going to start praising. And if you want to be moved by God, then sometimes you've got to move for God, how He wants the mighty to sing His praises. So if you're happy, praise. If you're sick, praise. If you're happy, pray. If you're hurting, pray. All of this stuff goes on all the time. Don't wait till you have to have it. Make it a constant thing in your life. Don't go into a season of drought or season of trouble. I like Frank. Frank's always here. Frank's always listening, but Frank has some hard times sometimes, don't you, Frank? Frank says things like this. He says, had a hard day. He said, but I just got up, said, thank you, Lord, for another day, and I just did what I was supposed to do. And then you see him up here, we call him Two Hands Frank. Because when it gets on him, he's going to have to let it out. You think about this for just a minute. It don't always feel right. It don't always feel good. We're sometimes in a mess and we can't control the situation, but we have a direct line for prayer and for praise to the one who holds the palm of the world in the palm of His hand. The one who makes all of this happen. The one that puts oxygen in the air, the one that gives you the breath to tie your shoes, the one that's giving you everything you got and everything you need for life and godliness. You have a direct line to the Master of all creation. So why in the world would we just not throw ourselves at the Savior's feet in prayer and praise anytime we have the opportunity? We'll pray. After we pray, we're going to give you the opportunity to do the same. So let's pray. Let's worship Him. Come on.
What?
You're going through a hard time here. There's going to be some people up front that can pray with you. Brother Frank, Greta, John, all these people in our church, they'd love to pray with you, pray over you. You're suffering hardship. This is the time to get released. Get you some help. God wants to help you. He doesn't want to leave you in the place you're at. Whatever you need, he's waiting on you. See, today we're going to be hearers and doers of the word. If you need to come pray, the altar is open. If you just want to praise the Lord, fixing the same. What better way than
service?
Just to do what God's called us to do. Stand. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for this place and your people. God, we worship you. God, we ask you to release the bondage in this place this morning. Touch hearts and souls and minds. Touch bodies. Whatever you want to do in this place, God, we're open to it, Father. Do what only you can. Restore, love, help, touch, heal. Move, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Release your fire into this place, Holy Spirit. Move upon us in Jesus' name. This is the time. Whatever you need, you can find it in the arms of God. You give life. Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. Our love.
Desire of our hearts, God. Pray and release some people in this place right now, God. God, release bondage. God, what the devil meant to destroy them. God, I know you plan for good. So God, let somebody in this place see, God, what you're doing in our lives right now.
We'll shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing.
Thank you.
You got glory. And people got free. Lord, bless these people that are seeking your face. God bless them, Father. Save the lost. Heal the sick. Help the saints. Do all that you said you'd do. You said in Jeremiah, I'm ready to perform my work. Lord, we stand here today saying we are ready to receive. We stand here with hands wide open, hearts wide open, minds wide open, just to receive whatever you have for us today in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You can be seated for just a minute. You're seated. Jack and Jesse are going to come take up the offering. We're going to watch some video announcements. We thank God for you being here. Thank God for all of our visitors. Make sure, visitors, you stop by the welcome desk. We've got a little gift to give you. We also like to sell your information to telemarketers. So, y'all have a blessed day in the Lord. We love you. And we love Jesus.
Raised around $7,600 for their upcoming trip. Please continue to pray for